Hello, my name is Sydney Halpin, and I'm the president of the New Jersey Jazz Society. It's my pleasure to welcome you to this presentation this afternoon, which is the last in a series with our partners at the Metuchen Arts Council Jazz. Before I forget, if you've missed any of the previous presentations, which were all equally wonderful, please go to the New Jersey Jazz Society YouTube channel page, and you can view them there. Again, they were all remarkable presentations, and if you've missed any of them, you can catch them there at your convenience. For those of you that don't know, the New Jersey Jazz Society is a 49-year-old organization that is dedicated to the performance, promotion, and preservation of jazz. If you'd like more information about the Jazz Society, please go to our website, njjs.org, and you will see that we have an award-winning digital publication available as part of membership. But today, for joining in, if you are not a member, you can access the publication with the code CARAVAN. That will be the password, CARAVAN with a capital C, and that will get you access for the magazine for the month of November. Before we proceed with today's program with David Haidu, which is going to be remarkable, I would just like to mention that for those of you who are in a position today to make a donation, that would be greatly appreciated. Any donations that we receive for this program are split equally between the two organizations, the Metuchen Art Council and ourselves, and it helps to offset the cost of programming, which, as you know, doesn't come for free. So again, if you've donated in the past, we thank you very much for your generosity. If you're in a position to be able to do that today, you can easily do that at the njjs.org website. Click on the donate button and it'll take you right through the process. We do process those donations through PayPal, but you do not have to have a PayPal account to make a credit card donation through that portal. Again, njjs.org if you're in a position to help us today. Also, if you have any questions and you're watching through the Facebook or YouTube pages, please type them in the comments and we will feed them to David, and he and Lynn will address them at the end of the program. So before we get started, I would like to say thank you very, very much to the Metuchen Arts Council for this marvelous partnership. It has been such a pleasure working with them, with Robert Dykin, Noel Cohen, and then, of course, my colleague who I'll introduce now, Lynn Mueller. Lynn Mueller is, the more I know about Lynn, the more my mind is boggled how absolutely involved she is in the jazz world and how many people she knows. She is truly a jazz scholar in her own right. She has been a tireless advocate for the institution of jazz. She has been a leader in her community, certainly with the Metuchen Arts Council and the jazz program. Through the Metuchen Arts Council, she really is just, there's so many wonderful things I could say about Lynn, but she's a wonderful, wonderful partner to work with. She's a delightful friend, and she is, again, a fierce advocate for jazz. So without further ado, thank you, Lynn, for this partnership. Thank you to your rest of your colleagues, and thank you for sharing the stage today.
Hi, Sydney. Thank you so much for the introduction. I hope that I can supported and everything. So we're happy to partner with New Jersey Jazz Society in presenting this virtual jazz education series. Thank you, Sydney. And also thank you to Sanford Josephson, who is the vice president of publicity. Sydney, of course, is the president. We are grateful for your significant help in publicizing and producing this virtual program. We also thank Christine Vanderlis, the Society's amazing video and sound engineer for this event. She's been amazing throughout all of the presentations that we've had. They couldn't have run as smoothly as they have without her help. So thank you, Christine. Since 1968, Metuchen Arts Council, or MAC, has been the premier arts organization in Metuchen, New Jersey, supporting and promoting all aspects of the arts, visual, music, theater, and dance. Led by co-chairs Bob Dykin and Judy Lee, MAC is quickly gaining wider recognition throughout Central New Jersey. Our website is metuchenartscouncil.com. Virtual Jazz Education Series joins our list of Metuchen jazz offerings, including festivals, concerts, and brunches. Previous jazz education presentations have been archived on njjs.org and YouTube, just as Sydney has mentioned. This is our sixth and final lecture for this year. I cannot think of a better way to end the season than with a presentation on Duke Ellington and Billy Strayhorn, the two beyond category composers of 20th century music. And the best person to speak about this is David Heydoux, widely recognized as the expert on Billy Strayhorn. David Heydoux is a professor at the Columbia University Graduate School of Journalism and a music critic for the magazine The Nation. He has just recently been appointed by President Biden to the National Council on the Humanities. Congratulations, David. David has written extensively for well-known publications, including The New Yorker, The Atlantic Monthly, among many others. His website is davidheydoux.com. David is a former president of the Duke Ellington Society. He spent 10 years researching his biography of Billy Strayhorn, which is titled Lush Life. Wildly acclaimed as in his historical connective as well as an important contribution to LGBTQ history, Heydoux's book has won many awards, including being named by the New York Times as one of the 100 best nonfiction books of all time. David has written extensively on music and popular culture in six other books. His most recent book, Adrian Gefell, is a fictional work of nonfiction. David is also a successful songwriter, working primarily as a lyricist in collaboration with jazz composer and pianist Rini Rosnes. As Sydney mentioned, please write your questions for David in the chat box during his presentation. Then at the end, he will answer them. David and I have been friends for many years, since our days in the Duke Ellington Society. So it is with great joy that I ask you to help me welcome David as he presents Ellington and Strayhorn, Alone and Together.
Thanks, Lynn. Thank you. Thanks, Lynn. And to both organizations, it warms my heart to do this in association with you because, as you mentioned, we go back 30 years.
That's right.
We were both 5 years old at the time.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
Right. Lynn was the president of the Duke Ellington Society. I had the honor of serving as her vice president. And then I served as the president with Ray Carman as the vice president. And then Ray Carman became the president until his recent death, sadly. I'm here to talk. I should mention, too, that I'm especially happy to do this for the New Jersey Jazz Society, being a Jersey boy myself. Born and raised in Warren County in Phillipsburg. Not a lot of jazz in Phillipsburg, but it's a nice place to grow up. And Strayhorn has a New Jersey connection. He lived briefly in Montclair for a while in his youth. It's a little known fact about Strayhorn's early life. Well, we're here to talk about two composers. One has been described in the following language. He's been described as a composer whose legacy will never be less than the ultimate on the highest plateau of culture, whether by comparison or not. Well, those are some words. Legacy that will never be less than the ultimate on the highest plateau of culture, whether by comparison or not. That's one composer we're going to talk about. The other composer we'll be talking about is the person who said that. The first is Billy Strayhorn. The second is Duke Ellington, who described Strayhorn that way. Now, how can there be two composers on the highest plateau of culture, you may ask? Well, it's a plateau. So, a plateau is flat. This plateau is flat. It's not a peak. A plateau is flat. So the highest plateau in the history of culture has room for more than one, does have room for more than two. And Strayhorn and Ellington certainly stand shoulder to shoulder there, along with a great many others. We're here to talk about those two. And picking up on Ellington's language, whether by comparison or not, we'll discuss them, we'll explore them, we'll think about them, we'll listen to their music, we'll consider how each of them was unique and what they did in association with each other and how each influenced the other. But we're going to avoid judgment by comparison in honor of Ellington's request to not compare. Let's start by considering the elder of these two, Duke Ellington, who was 16 years older than Billy Strayhorn. Ellington was, I teach at Columbia, this is my office at Columbia, I teach a seminar that takes place over 3 months. We could devote 3 months to talking about either of these figures, and then another 3 months, and then another 3 years. There's so much to say and so much to think about. We're going to discuss and think about a handful of ideas about the two of them. One of them, we could start with this, and that's the fact that Ellington is historically significant and influential in a great many ways. And one of them is the fact that he made possible this very discussion. He made possible the discussion of a jazz musician, African-American jazz musician, as a great composer. Because prior to him, those terms were wrongly thought of as mutually exclusive. Ellington, by design, strategically sought and succeeded at bridging that divide and bringing together the values that had valorized and celebrated composers in the white European tradition for years, and mostly African Americans, almost purely African Americans, who developed and refined jazz to an art form of equal sophistication and stature. Oh, I'm using equal. I just promised to not compare. But of deep, deep sophistication, complexity, and emotionality. So how did Ellington make this possible? He did it intentionally. And one of the ways was by working, setting up business with a music publisher named Irving Mills. So he chose Irving Mills as his business partner. Irving Mills was a publisher, not a booking agent. He didn't book acts like most of the people who other jazz musicians and African-American musicians went into partnership with. He was a music publisher. Ellington wanted his compositions to be published and to be thought of as worthy of being published. Under Irving Mills, by way of Ellington, in 1933, a press manual was published. It was a guidebook for journalists and other writers writing about Duke Ellington. I'm going to read you a little excerpt from this guidebook. 1933 guidebook by the Mills Organization for journalists. I'm going to read you from the guidebook. In your campaign, do not treat Duke Ellington as just another jazz band leader. And do not try to sell the orchestra merely with phrases such as, quote, the hottest band on earth, end quote. Ellington's genius as a composer, arranger, and musician has won him the respect and admiration of such authorities as Percy Grainger, head of the Department of Music at New York University. You know, we don't have any grudges against NYU here at Columbia. I went to NYU myself. Basil Cameron, conductor of the Seattle Symphony Orchestra, Leopold Stokowski, famed conductor of the celebrated Philadelphia Orchestra, Paul Whiteman, whose name is synonymous with jazz, and many others. Sell Ellington as a great artist, a musical genius. I had a little computer problem on my end, I'm sorry. A musical genius whose unique style and individual theories of harmony have created a new music. sell his orchestra as a class attraction, the group of stellar artists whose performances have stimulated an international interest in the type of music which they have introduced. Do not hesitate to approach music editors and music critics on the subject of Ellington. He has been accepted seriously by many of the greatest minds in the world of music, who have regarded it a privilege to study his art and discuss his theories with him. Now, this is 1933, and Duke Ellington had been earning that stature for years already. As early as 1927, he was established in his sphere as a bandleader, musician, pianist, and a composer of deep originality and creative ambition. Through some specific works, and we'll talk about one for just a few minutes. We'll talk about Black and Tan Fantasy. I'm going to share a screen. I did practice this before the event. It should work. But if I call up, you know, my students' papers or pictures of my kids, you'll know I clicked the wrong box. So here we go. Is that sharing? This is the sheet music for Black and Tan Fantasy, published by Mills Music. I'm sorry for the small size of it. I couldn't figure out how to make it full screen. I apologize for that. And here is an image of Duke Ellington with his ensemble at that point. We called it an orchestra. It was an orchestra of six pieces. There's Ellington on the right. And behind him, over his right shoulder, standing to our left, is Bubba Miley, who's his collaborator on Black and Tan Fantasy. And note the elegance with which they were attired, the black tie, and the elegance with which they comported themselves, which gave kind of physical, visual form to the refinement that his music embodied. I'm going to play a bit of the music from Black and Tan Fantasy and flip to YouTube. We're going to use YouTube as a source for the music. You'll see one of those, you know, generic YouTube still images when we do that, but I'll ask you to focus on the music rather than the still image, and we'll hear Black and Tan Fantasy in its entirety. Black and Tan Fantasy, 1927. Come on. There. Don't worry, I know what I have to do. There we go.
What has a woman's uterus got to do with your prostate? No. Researchers have now uncovered a strange connection between these...
Little glitch, sorry, I apologize.
Thank you. This is the world's first reusable cotton swab. It removes up to 5 times.
Okay. And now we learned about the world's first reusable cotton swab. At the same time, you're getting so much, learning so much today. So within a few years, Ellington was fairly successfully established as a composer of exceptional creativity and creative ambition. And this was portrayed in 1935 in a Hollywood short film called Symphony in Black. I want us to consider the messages of this film, and I'll show a short clip from the film. This is a Paramount short feature released in 1935 called Symphony in Black. And when you watch this, just to ask you to kind of decode the symbols that you're seeing in this image and what they mean and what it's intended to tell us about Duke Ellington. Here we go. This is Symphony in Black, 1935. All right, this is working, right? Okay, here we go. To talk a little bit about what this video communicates. It shows Duke Ellington with his own office. He's a successful professional. He keeps an office. He gets a telegram from a major arts institution of arts presentation, like the fictive parallel to Carnegie Hall, to fulfill a commission. He's commissioned to compose not a set of jazz pieces, not some dance music, but a symphony. And we now witness the composer working alone in a garret. You know, it's like the attic, it's like the image of, you know, Mozart, or, you know, great composer of the European tradition, composing alone in a solitary way with the kind of light streaming in as if, you know, inspiration would stream down from the heavens to his shoulders. And where he was working alone with a pencil on music manuscript to compose his a masterpiece in symphonic form. Now, Ellington did compose a manuscript. There are 5,000 pieces of evidence of this at the Library of Congress. He not only did he compose a music manuscript with pencil, but sometimes on menus and placemats, whatever was available, there's a shirt down there. He got an idea and he made a musical staff on his shirt and jotted down an idea. He did. He was inspired and constantly to compose and composed constantly. So the film depicts some truths about him, but it depicts the truths that map, overlay the image of the white male classical genius, so as to establish Ellington as a genius to those who know that framework and have no other framework to consider the form that genius could take. So Ellington was quite brilliant in tactically establishing himself in this way through the symbolism because it accomplished a couple of things. One is it successfully did establish him as a composer, but then that was just the first step in what this strategy accomplished. Once Ellington is established as a great composer, it prepares audiences and listeners and critics and social mediators, cultural mediators, to consider that whatever music he makes, whatever form it takes, whatever genre it is, whatever style it is, must have greatness if it's the result, if it's created by a great composer. So once establishing that he uses the techniques that we know have been used by great composers to make symphonic works and orchestral works and chamber music and works in the forms that we know from the Western classical music, then we could consider that maybe there's greatness in hybrid forms or in dance music or in popular forms of music or ballads or styles of music that we don't quite have the language or a term to describe because this person is innovating them as he did. We could hear the degree of his innovation in Black and Tan Fantasy. What kind of music is that? It's hard to categorize. That was Ellington's highest compliment to anyone, is that he or she or they or their work were beyond category. He basically defined being beyond category. So once established as a great composer, it opened up the possibility that whatever he composed was great. It opened up another possibility, and significant possibility, that what he composed could be great whether or not it was made by these means. Because the film, while depicting part of Ellington's process, largely misrepresented his process. He worked more significantly in a communal, collaborative way with his orchestra. He wrote for the individual voices of his musicians. We could hear how that piece is geared around the plunger trumpet effects of Bubba Miley, that effect, fabulous, beautiful, so evocative, unique sound. Ellington knew Bubba Miley can do this and composed a piece around what Bubba Miley as an individual could contribute. So he's working in a collaborative, communal, give and take, call and response way. Has deep roots in the African-American tradition and distinguishes this kind of music making in a significant way from the Western classical tradition of the individual genius communing with the gods to create a single work that then is given form by the musicians. Ellington is working collaboratively and encouraging the members of his ensemble and a whole group of creative collaborators to contribute in a meaningful way to give the music made by his organization, which we would call Ellingtonia, its distinctive style. It's a distinctive style we associate with Duke Ellington, but it's constructed by this group of contributors. Absolutely brilliant and significant. And the Ellington method, historical, and then we now accept it as a given, but it was a radical idea in mainstream culture at that time. Now, meanwhile, how are we doing on time? Okay. Meanwhile, in 1935, the same year as Symphony in Black, another composer named William Thomas Strayhorn, Billy Strayhorn, though his mother called him Bill, was reaching full bloom in Pittsburgh and demonstrating his own unique capacity to compose highly original works in a distinctive style that defied classification. 16 years younger than Ellington, Strayhorn was only 20 in 1935. Ellington was 36. And he had already composed the masterpiece that would come to define him, Lush Life. Lush Life was already a year old when he was 20 in 1935, as well as a remarkable body of unique, distinctive, individualistic works that had been heard around Pittsburgh and you know, the surrounding areas, and even as far as, you know, northern West Virginia, where his band once played, but weren't known beyond those borders. Strayhorn was steeped in both classical music and jazz, as well as theater music and art form. He performed the Grieg Piano Concerto in his high school graduation, While still in his teens, he composed a waltz called Vals that his music teachers mistook for works, a work of the, from the classical canon. It's since been discovered and performed, and it's the love theme of a movie called Girl Fight. And if you're wondering how good can this thing by a high school student really be, it's on YouTube and you can check it out, Vals. He had composed a concerto for piano and timpani, performed also in his high school. After high school, he attended the Pittsburgh Musical Institute, and he wrote a complete musical review, book, words, music, orchestral arrangements called Fantastic Rhythm that played for several years all around the Pittsburgh area and was actually even produced overseas when it was taken up by its producers. His producer was joined the Navy. It was produced in the Pacific by the producer. He had a trio called the Mad Hatters that performed Lush Life, Something to Live For, Your Love Has Faded, and other compositions that would later become associated with Duke Ellington and are still widely performed today and recognized as standards. I'm going to share screen for a second and just show you few things from this period in Strayhorn's life. Come on. So here is, you can see that, right? Yes. This is a music manuscript to Fantastic Rhythm in Strayhorn's hand. So I had this for many years. It's now at the Library of Congress, along with other materials related to Fantastic Rhythm that I had gathered from my research on Strayhorn's life. And here is a poster for Fantastic Rhythm. One of the dancers had saved this and folded it and put it in a drawer. And then at one point she unfolded it and taped it together. And then over the decades, the tape yellowed. But here it is. So it's a poster for Fantastic Rhythm. I think what I'll do is keep this share screen, and I'll just talk over a couple of images so you can see a few things. No, I'm going to change my mind. Hey, this is a jazz presentation, so we can improvise, right? I think that's my prerogative. So Strayhorn had a trio. He had written a number of songs that would go on to become standards. He had written a complete musical show. He had written some classical pieces, some hybrid pieces, and he had also done some arranging for local orchestras, for local jazz orchestras, for two or three local jazz orchestras, and full big band arrangements. Through the intervention of a friend of his named George Greenlee, who's Strayhorn ended up being introduced to Duke Ellington. George Greenlee's uncle was Gus Greenlee, who owned not only the Pittsburgh Crawfords franchise and the Negro Leagues, the baseball league, but also the two leading nightclubs in Pittsburgh, the Crawford Grill and the Crawford Grill 2. And George Greenlee, by way of Gus Greenlee, arranged for Duke Ellington to meet Billy Strayhorn. They met in December 1938. Strayhorn played some things for him that he had composed. He had the audacity to play two Ellington songs for him and then go on to play them the way that he would play them. And then over the course of several days, they had back and forth. Ellington asked him to try arranging a couple of things that then he had the orchestra perform while the orchestra was in Pittsburgh. And after a couple of days of this, Ellington said, well, I think I could find a place for you in my organization. Come to New York and look me up. And he wrote down directions to get to his house by subway in Sugar Hill in Harlem. And Strayhorn got the idea to take those subway directions and to impress his prospective boss. The relationship was never defined at that point and would never be defined for the rest of their long association until Strayhorn's death in 1966. But he got the inspiration to set these subway directions to music. And they are, of course, Take the A Train. I'm going to play an unusual version of Take the A Train for you. This is a version recorded by a record company that Ellington started called Mercer Records, named after his son, attributed to Oscar Pettiford, his cello and quartet. It's Ellington on piano, Billy Strayhorn on celeste, Lloyd Trotman and Joe Jones on drum. Here's the actual record. Whoops. This is the original 78. And I'm gonna play this for you. That's an early recording of Take the A Train. No, not there. Hold on. Wait a minute. What did I do? Okay. Nope, not that. Not that. Here it is. Where is it? Wait a minute, where is it? Ah! Where is it? Oh no, I'm so embarrassed. Ah, here it is.
For my wallet, I just wanted three things. It had to be simple, really easy to access your cards, and last forever. Thank you.
This image on screen for a second, just to talk over this, and then I'll come back. This is the cover of the CD reissue, actually vinyl and CD reissue of this material that was originally released on 78 Shellac record. Great times. Duke Ellington. Notice the size of Ellington's name and the smaller size of Billy Strayhorn's name, and notice that the image shows Ellington dominating, apparently demonstrating something to Billy Strayhorn. This is quite a bit after the fact. The way that those all the material on that reissue was originally released under Ellington's Aegisus, under the label that he owned, focused on Strayhorn. Some of the recordings was issued as a duet by Ellington and Strayhorn. Certainly not with Ellington and Strayhorn. Most of the duets were attributed to the Billy Strayhorn Trio, because Ellington thought that Strayhorn's name should be prominent. The Billy Strayhorn Trio. Or if for larger ensembles, Billy Strayhorn and his All-Stars. Billy Strayhorn and his All-Stars. This is the original release of the material on that reissue. Or under the name of a small group, there was a one-off that they named for the recording sessions, the Coronets, Juan Tiesel, Willie Smith, and some other people associated with the Ellington Orchestra. One-off studio-only band called Never Played Any Gigs, called the Coronets. But, you know, Ellington's name is not prominent in any of them. What did they do once Ellington followed those subway directions and took the A train up to Sugar Hill and started working in association with Duke Ellington? They did a great many things over several decades. One is Strayhorn contributed original pieces he had composed prior to meeting Ellington, such as Something to Live For and Your Love Has Faded, and Lush Life also, which the orchestra never very rarely played, but did occasionally play. And I'm gonna play some recordings of them in a minute. First I want to go through like the various forms and colors and shades and mutations that their association took. One is Strayhorn contributed stuff he had already written before he met Duke. Two, he contributed pieces in the vein of the orchestral jazz that Ellington had been doing, but with a strain of his own sensibility, which is kind of a modernist sensibility. Take the A Train has a kind of angularity. It's a kind of a proto-bop piece. It has a kind of angularity that foreshadows bop. We can hear that in Take the A Train, 1938. Rain Check, Johnny Come Lately. Other pieces Strayhorn wrote that feel utterly at home, played on the bandstand by the Duke Ellington Orchestra. They fit the orchestra, but they have a bit of a strain of individuality, a bit of something new and something modernist, and that's Strayhorn's Touch. He did arrangements of Ellington's compositions, often in service of Ellington, honoring Ellington's voice and style. I Got It Bad and That Ain't Good is a good example of that. There are literally dozens of orchestrations, arrangements of I Got It Bad, a repository in Washington, all in Strayhorn's hand. But they're clearly intended to serve Ellington, to sound like Ellington. It's Ellington composition in all probability. Although, sounds a bit like Strayhorn's, all probability in Ellington composition, arranged by Strayhorn in service to Ellington. He sometimes reinvented Ellington compositions. There's a fabulous LP called Masterpieces by Ellington, and all but one of them were reinventions of Ellington material by Strayhorn, with both Strayhorn and Ellington alternating at the keyboard, sometimes Strayhorn playing piano. And then, in addition, he contributed pieces that were utterly unique and distinctive and all his own. And this is, much to Ellington's credit, something that made total sense in the Duke Ellington Orchestra. Because Ellington was dedicated to giving the participants in his ensemble, in his arena, the freedom to find their own voice and bring their own voice and their sensibility and their style to the contribute to the larger whole. Sometimes Ellington and the orchestra would take a subordinate role, subordinate themselves to the individual composer, to the voice of the individual composer, as they did with Strayhorn's compositions, like the most distinctive of which Sound Like Nobody Else, Passion Flower, Chelsea Bridge, Flowers of Love, Some Thing. They have strains of classical music, particularly the Impressionist. They have a deep harmonic sophistication. They're highly advanced musically, through composed, not episodic, and have an emotional sensitivity, sometimes a bittersweet quality, sometimes a mournfulness, and sometimes an aching quality, and then also sometimes a wry, kind of sassy wit or sophisticated wit. Sometimes those qualities are perceived as evidence of a gay sensibility, which is arguable and would make sense in Strayhorn's case, in that he was homosexual. However you read them, they're utterly distinctive and wholly Strayhorn's own, and as much to Ellington's credit that he not just allowed, but encouraged Strayhorn to use his orchestra to give voice to this sensibility. I want to give an example of one specimen of this. I'm going to play a performance of Chelsea Bridge. This is from this kind of fairly late in Strayhorn's association with Ellington in the 1960s with Paul Gonzalez. I'm playing this version because there's a video of it. It's a nice video, but you get a sense of what I'm talking about when I talk about Strayhorn's sensibility. Chelsea Bridge. Oh. Well, I'm so sorry. I feel so embarrassed. Why isn't it playing? Chelsea Bridge. Here we go.
For another day's Strayhorn composition, It's Paul Gonsalves and Chelsea Bridge.
Note that he said we'll play another Billy Strayhorn composition, Chelsea Bridge. I'm going to play a few more musical selections for you that that demonstrate a bit more of what Strayhorn brought to the world of Ellingtonia. I'll play the first performance of Lush Life under the aegis of Ellington. It's at Carnegie Hall, 1948. With Strayhorn at the piano and the singer Kay Davis singing. And then I'm going to play this. Remember, this is a song from Strayhorn's Days in Pittsburgh, Something to Live For, which Ella Fitzgerald more than once called her favorite song, all-time favorite song. And I want you to listen to the way that she introduces it. And I'll come back and talk about a few other aspects of their association. So if I could do this properly without calling up my student papers, I think Lost July 1st and then Something to Live For. Well, maybe, you know what? Maybe we'll just do, oh, here it is, yay. No, that's not it. Ah. Hold on, don't go, don't leave, stay. Okay, I think because I'm such a yo-yo. Wait, aha, here we go.
And here we go. You see this little device right here? Well, I'm going to show you something right now. Now, some people are right.
Okay.
And now I'd like to introduce the writing and arranging companion who we've been so much indebted to for quite a bit.
I'm going to start that again.
And now I'd like to.
So you could hear Duke Ellington's introduction to this piece. This is the way he introduced it at Carnegie Hall in 1948. Just take a listen, take a close listen to his introduction.
Who's the writing and arranging companion who we've been so much indebted to for quite a period for contributing so much of the so many of the high spots of our performances, particularly in the writing. I'd like to, at this time, present Billy Strayhorn. Of course, you know, Billy Strayhorn wrote out, you take the A train. And now, the purpose, of course, of him appearing on tonight's program, this is a little extra added and extra added thought, I should say, is that I'd like for him to have Kay Davis to play, rather, for Kay Davis to introduce a new tune of his called Lush Life. Kay Davis.
I used to visit all the very gay places, those come what may places, where one relaxes on the axis of the wheel of life to get the feel of life from jazz. The guys I knew had sad and sullen gray faces with g-string gauges. That used to be there, you could see where they'd been washed away by too many through the day. 12 o'clock days. Then you came along with your siren song to tempt me to madness. I thought for a while that your poignant smile was tinged with the sadness of a great love for me. Ah, yes, I was wrong. Life is lonely again, and only last year everything seemed so sure. Now life is awful again. A truffle of hearts could only be a bore. A week in Paris will ease the might of it. All I care is to smile in spite of it. I'll forget you, I will, while yet you are still burning inside my brain. Romance is mush, stifling those who strive. I'll live a lush life in some small dive, and there I'll be while I rot with the rest of those whose lives are lonely too. A week in Paris will ease the bite of it. All I care is to smile in spite of it. I'll forget you, I will, while yet you are still burning inside my brain. Romance is mush, stifling those who strive. I'll live a lush life in some small dive, and there I'll be while I rot with the rest of those whose lives are lonely too.
Beautiful performance. You can hear that the orchestra comes in only at the very end, for a single chord at the very end. For the sake of time, there are a couple of other things I want to play while we have this. While we have this time, so I'm not going to play the Ella Fitzgerald version of Something to Live For. I'll just point you to look it up yourself on YouTube. It's live concert at Stockholm with the Duke Ellington Orchestra. It's a wonderful performance of the song that, again, she more than once called her favorite song. I wanted to play it mainly as an example of how what Strayhorn brought to the Ellington Orchestra from his earlier life. Now, together, Strayhorn and Ellington's association is hard to grasp. It's hard to put our fingers on, because our image of collaborators is framed from like Hollywood movies of, you see the Words of Music, the movie about Rodgers and Hart, and, you know, countless other Hollywood movies of collaborators and one sitting there and playing off each other and inspiring, prodding each other on, inspiring each other, working together. Strayhorn and Ellington, for the most part, worked independently. Strayhorn, for the most part, and there are exceptions, but it's only a handful. It's maybe two handfuls of exceptions. For the most part, Strayhorn wrote his compositions, and the Ellington Orchestra played them, or Ellington wrote composition and the Ellington Orchestra played them. There are a handful of cases where they worked on the same piece together. There are more pieces where Strayhorn arranged for Ellington. But for the sweets that are often thought of as, you know, Ellington's kind of great statement, the sweets that are attributed to the two of them by Duke Ellington and Doyle Strayhorn, Strayhorn tended to write a couple of selections, and Ellington wrote more as a rule, actually, and they put the two of them together. And you could hear once you are a little bit exposed to, oh, that's Strayhorn, oh, that's Ellington, you could hear in a suite, oh, that's a Strayhorn tune, there's a Duke, then that's another Duke, and here comes a Stray. You could kind of hear it pretty clearly. In some cases, the works were repurposed. Like there's a Strayhorn composition called Pretty Girl that he originally wrote for Johnny Hodges, was recorded by Johnny Hodges with a Billy Strayhorn arrangement that was later retitled and incorporated into the Ellington Strayhorn suite dedicated to Shakespeare called Such Sweet Thunder. So they both like to repurpose, and they would repurpose things. For this Far East suite, they repurposed a tune that Strayhorn had written originally called Elf, renamed it Isfahan. Originally had nothing to do with the Middle East. The Far East suite is about the Middle East. So just to keep us on edge, Isfahan was originally Elf. So they would repurpose, kind of shuffle things, always to kind of keep people guessing, and then sustain an aura of mystery around the work. I have some photos I want to show. Since we're in this through the intimacy of this technology, I can show you some pictures. This is the band that played that first version of Take the A Train that I heard, Oscar Pettiford, Lloyd Trotman, Ellington, Strayhorn. And the person on the right that I'll show you is the producer, Leonard Feather. There we go. Isn't that great? There we go. Strayhorn, so that's Oscar Pettiford on the left, Strayhorn, Ellington lying down, Lloyd Trotman, bassist, and Leonard Feather, the producer. I'm gonna show you a couple of pictures of Ellington and Strayhorn together. This is a classic image of the two of them together in the recording studio, you know, side by side, kind of, you know, each, you know, Strayhorn's probably contributing. Ellington is no doubt leading the sessions, and Ellington is contributing some ideas, although Strayhorn did occasionally lead sessions. This is one of my favorite pictures of Ellington and Strayhorn. So this is in a recording studio, and there's Ellington at the piano. But whenever he wanted, he would look up, and there's Strayhorn. So Strayhorn staring at him with this piercing gaze, where he could signal to him at any point whatever he wanted to signal to Ellington. It's a couple of glossy photos. Duke Ellington's glossy from the 40s, late 1940s, and Strayhorn at the same time. This is by William Gottlieb, shows Strayhorn. Now, in addition to working together, they each worked independently too, and I want to devote a little bit of time to that. Strayhorn, during his association with Ellington, composed extensively for a fraternal organization in Harlem called the Copacetics, that once a year staged a gala. It was a fundraiser for the community, that Strayhorn wrote a full show every year that would be performed as a benefit for the Copacetics. Wrote dozens of compositions for this, recorded, published virtually none of them until they have been rediscovered largely through the initiative of a brilliant musicologist from the Netherlands, Walter Vandeleur, who I consider like my brother in Strayhorn and Ellington studies, who unearthed some of this music and recorded it with the Dutch Jazz Orchestra. And the Strayhorn family, under the leadership of Elise Clairvaux, has also been has now organized those materials and prepared them for performance. So the copacetics, here's a painting of the copacetics, fraternal organization, mostly tap dancers. Strayhorn was the president of the organization, and there was their organization's esteem for him was such that when, upon his death, they retired the title of the president. There was never another president. For the period of the early 1950s, period of 3.5 years, they parted company, and Strayhorn contributed nothing for the Duke Ellington Orchestra. They had a parting of the ways, and it was not publicized. There was nothing on the record about this at the time. Everyone in the world knew. They reunited before the late 1950s and ended up doing some masterpieces together as collaborators. But during this period when they were apart, Strayhorn gravitated to the avant-garde world, and he composed the music for an off-Broadway performance of a Federico Garcia Lorca play called The Love of Don Perlimplin for Belisa in the Garden. Lorca being a great kind of gay martyr was important to Strayhorn and his colleagues and contemporaries in the 1950s in the demimonde of the gay world in New York at the time. Magnificent music, unrecorded and unpublished at the time. He also recorded and toured with Lena Horne. Strayhorn, Ellington continued to record with his orchestra and also in various other settings. When Strayhorn fell ill in the 1960s, his illness and death in 1966 hit Ellington quite hard. And Ellington at that point turned and devoted the rest of his life until his death in 1974 to the composition and recording of sacred music. He was struck to kind of such a deep reassessment of his life that in his meaning through this shattering experience that he devoted himself to God and to sacred music for the rest of his life. I want to wrap up the formal part of this before we take questions, open up the floor to questions, with two pieces of music. One is one of the last pieces that Strayhorn wrote. It's he wrote a 3-movement suite for the piano and French horn duo of Dwight Mitchell and Willie Ruff, the Mitchell-Ruff duo. It's called Suite for the Duo, and it was released after Strayhorn's death. I'll play the first movement of it. And then I want to wrap up by playing a film clip of Ellington around the same time performing a composition by Billy Strayhorn called Lotus Blossom. Strayhorn's and Ellington's intimates in those days, several of them described to me watching Duke play Lotus Blossom when he was alone prior to a show or after a show, or alone in a rehearsal studio, just over and over and over. He just couldn't let go of Lotus Blossom. So I'm going to play a bit of one of the last pieces that Strayhorn wrote before his death. It's called Sweep for the Duo. We'll hear the first movement, and then we will hear and see Duke Ellington play Lotus Blossom.
This little device right here saved my wife's life last night. I'll tell you how.
Thank you.
Okay, so I'm going to wrap up the formal part of this by playing one more musical clip. And this is video of Duke Ellington playing Lotus Blossom, the Billy Strayhorn composition. Okay.
And now I'd like to play a tune written by Billy Strayhorn. It's about my favorite, possibly. And it's called Lotus Blossom. It's very seldom heard.
While hospitals have doctors and nurses, we have mom and dad. Because at Ronald McDonald House Charities, we help families feel at home, even when they can't be.
Thank you.
Well, I did promise to wrap up by 4, so we'd have half an hour for questions, and I didn't. I'm sorry. But I'm here to take any questions you have.
Okay, so David, thank you very much for addressing how Ellington and Strayhorn transformed American music on their own and as musical companions. Noel Cohen has a question. Why doesn't the composition Lush Life play a larger role in Ellington's repertoire? And does the arrangement of Lush Life for the full orchestra written by either Duke or Billy exist?
Yeah, there is an arrangement for the full orchestra written by Strayhorn that Walter Vandeler has uncovered and is available by way for performance through the Strayhorn estate. I did ask members of the orchestra why they thought. Ellington was not around to ask him, hey Duke, why didn't you play Lost Light more often? They did it from time to time. Why didn't you play it more often? Members of the orchestra thought, they assumed it was because it was such a Strayhorn thing. It was so purely Strayhorn that Ellington wanted to honor that, you know, and maybe not step on it, you know, keep it with Strayhorn, and out of deference to him and on honor of Strayhorn. Mm-hmm. But we don't know for sure.
Mm-hmm. Okay. We had talked earlier about possibly reading what Duke wrote about Strayhorn from your book, Lush Life. And your book is absolutely fabulous. I recommend it to everyone. It's concise, and it tells you totally about Billy Strayhorn. So it's...
We'll do that, and then we'll wrap that. Yes, close with that.
I think that would be a great close.
Okay, we'll close. Actually, the very opening quote was from this eulogy that Duke Ellington spoke at St. Peter's Church after Strayhorn's death in 1966. And this is what Ellington wrote and said that day. Poor little sweepy, Billy Strayhorn, William Thomas Strayhorn, the biggest human being who ever lived, a man with the greatest courage, the most majestic artistic stature, a highly skilled musician with whose impeccable taste commanded the respect of all musicians and the admiration of all listeners. His audiences at home and abroad marveled at the grandeur of his talent and the mantle of tonal supremacy that he wore only with grace. He was a beautiful human being, adored by a wide range of friends, rich, poor, famous, and unknown. Great artists paid homage to Billy Strayhorn's God-given abilities and mastery of his craft. He spoke English perfectly and French very well, but condescension did not enter his mind. He demanded freedom of expression and lived in what we consider the most important and moral of freedoms. Freedom from hate, unconditionally. Freedom from self-pity, even through all the pain and bad news. Freedom from fear of possibly doing something that might help another more than it might help himself. And freedom from the kind of fear that could make a man feel that he was better than his brother or his neighbor. His patience was incomparable and unlimited. He had no aspirations and to enter into any kind of competition. Yet, the legacy he leaves, his oeuvre, will never be less than the ultimate on the highest plateau of culture, whether by comparison or not. God bless Billy Strayhorn.
Thank you, David, very much.
Thank you.
But before we go, you have just received a nomination to the National Council of the Humanities. You were nominated by President Biden. Could you tell us a little bit more about that?
Well, I wish I knew more about it. It came out of the blue. I've never occupied, never been part of that sphere, but I was put forward to serve on the National Council for the Humanities. And it's a great honor. And we mostly spend money. we mostly adjudicate, make decision grants for, by creative artists around the country. I'm very excited about it and extremely nervous because the other members of the council, you know, much fancier than I am. So I'm pretty nervous about it, but excited too to have this opportunity to maybe have a little influence on the kind of art that gets made and where it gets made. So I'm quite excited, but thank you for bringing it up. It's a nice honor and as well as a nerve-wracking one. Thank you.
I know that you will be a perfect person on that committee. I just
thank you.
So comfortable with that. So now I address the audience. If you like what you saw and heard today, and we know you did, please consider making a donation at www.njjs.org. Any amount is appreciated, and contributions are shared equally between New Jersey Jazz Society and Metuchen Arts Council and help defray the costs of these events. This is our last jazz education event for 2021. We thank you for your interest and participation in this series of presentations. Did you enjoy them? Would you be interested in their continuation in 2022? We would like to hear from you. Please send me an email to metuchenjazz@gmail.com. Today's program will be archived on the New Jersey Jazz Society website, njjs.org, and YouTube channel for your continued viewing pleasure. Happy Thanksgiving, happy holidays. Thank you, and goodbye for now.